been such a long time for fans of the Boston Red Sox and fans of the St. Louis Cardinals to enjoy the Fall Classic. And we hope you enjoy this Fall Classic. Tonight on Fox, we begin the Boston Red Sox, the St. Louis Cardinals. That's got a nice ring to it. The fans are ready to pack into Fenway. They're here ready to roll. And so are we. The American League champion Boston Red Sox taking on the champ from the National League, the St. Louis Cardinals. And now welcome to the broadcast booth, everybody. I'm Joe Buck. Tim, in just a second. Well, did you like the LCS play? We certainly did. The National League Championship Series, fantastic. With the Cardinals outlasting the Houston Astros, it took seven games. They're here. The Boston Red Sox made history by coming back down three games to none to not only beat the Yankees, but to win the final two games at Yankee Stadium. And Tim McCarver, you look at this matchup. So many people thought that this would be an exciting matchup. We'll wait and see. But it is definitely an old school type matchup with Boston and St. Louis.
Well, it's so impressive not only that these two teams are here, but how they got here. As you mentioned, the Cardinals winning their last two games against the Houston Astros and St. Louis to be here in Boston. And the Red Sox, in historical fashion, beating the vaunted New York Yankees. Think about how confident both these teams are starting the World Series, realizing that if they get down, they can come back.
Two teams that are red hot. What do we expect? We expect to see a lot of offense, and we'll wait and see which bullpen can hang on to and nail down wins. Oh, one other thing. They're ready to go in Fenway, and they will be ready to go in Busch Stadium. Two of the most emotionally charged fan bases in all of sports set to do battle in this year's World Series. Degrees. And for more on tonight's weather and this knuckleballer, let's go down to Chris Myers.
Thanks, Joe. Currently 49 degrees here down on the field. Rain will not be a factor, but the wind and the cold will be tonight, especially for knuckleballer Tim Wakefield. His catcher, Doug Mirabelli, telling me this evening that it's best for the knuckleball with the wind blowing in the pitcher's face. That's not the case tonight. It's blowing from his back about 15 to 20 miles per hour. Now, the temperature could dip into the 30s with the wind chill factor as the evening wears on. So more than the grip, the feel for the ball may be a problem for Wakefield. So the best thing for him to do is sweat. That's right, sweat. Moisture will give him more of a grip and make him more effective when he throws the knuckleball. You always hear, hey, don't sweat the little things. But for Tim Wakefield, he wants to sweat, and this is a big thing.
All right, Chris, thanks for the report. Good luck sweating on a night like this. His regular season 30 starts. The record of 12-10, and as big a part of the ALCS victory for the Red Sox as just about anybody else you can pick out of that bullpen for Boston.
Well, what Tim Wakefield and the Red Sox would like would be a swirling win. Early strikes, very important, because if he doesn't throw the knuckleball over early, then he's got to resort to the curveball and look for the Cardinals to run. And that wind whipping in from center field. As Terry Francona told us before the game, if the wind is at the back of Tim Wakefield, there could be a lot of pass balls.
Baseball fans, grab a cold, fresh Budweiser. It's game time. And pitch number one of this 2004 World Series is about to come toward Edgar Renteria, with Larry Walker batting second, Pujols hitting third. And it's this matchup of Wakefield and Woody Williams here in game one. For Tim Wakefield, his 10th year with the Boston Red Sox. More than willing to do anything it took to get Boston into this position, and he gets the ball in game one. Strike one. Renteria hit .287 during the regular season, 10 home runs. It's 0-2. So far for Renteria, .257 average in the postseason, 6 RBIs. And for game seven of the NLCS, and maybe not just tonight in the World Series, Renteria is up in the leadoff spot. Place held usually by Tony Womack. One ball, two strikes. Packed in that dugout. A lot of extra players that are on the trip with St. Louis. Renteria strikes out. And a good start for Wakefield tonight. Once again, tonight's starting lineup for the St. Louis Cardinals brought to you by Citibank. You know Renteria, now it's Larry Walker in the number two spot. Albert Pujols, the NLCS MVP, then Scott Rolen. Jim Evans in center, Reggie Sanders the DH, Tony Womack batting seventh. Mike Matheny, so Taguchi is in left field batting in the number nine spot. Here's Larry Walker. If anybody should feel comfortable playing baseball in this weather, it's Larry Walker. From Maple Ridge, British Columbia, 16th season of the big leagues and finally in the World Series. One ball, one strike.
Larry, a big hockey fan. And speaking of hockey, Mike Ruzioni, the captain of the 1980 Team USA that beat Russia and Finland to win the gold medal, sent the Boston Red Sox some miracle t-shirts. Obviously referring to the miracle comeback of the Red Sox over the Yankees, winning four in a row.
Here's a 2-1 to Walker on the inside corner, 2-2.
That was a fastball, the first fastball thrown.
Walker just gets a piece. In fact, we've seen Wakefield plenty already in the ALCS, and I'm sure you could count the number of fastballs that he threw to the Yankees on one hand.
Yeah, most of the time to the Yankees, he relied on the curveball, and he had to throw something other than the knuckle.
Walker waits on it and fouls it out of play. So the count's still 2-2. These two teams have met a couple of times in the World Series in 46 and in 67. And you look at the postseason career for Tim Wakefield. 5-1 in LCS play. The one loss, game seven of last year's ALCS. Walker got a good rip. It's still 2-2. Tony La Russa in his ninth season with the St. Louis Cardinals. And for La Russa, his fourth World Series appearance since he's been with St. Louis, his first. The 2-2 to Walker. Just missed, full count.
It's the one thing you don't usually see. Batters taking a called third strike on a knuckleball. They're very anxious, and more often than not, they swing at bad balls like that one.
And the count stays full. How odd is it to see these two teams tonight in game one of the World Series after both were involved in must-win situations where entire series and seasons were riding from time to time on one pitch or one play. Walker hits it down the right field line. That ball is fair and into the corner. Larry Walker will dig for two and make it to second with a one-out double.
That ball short hopping the right field fence before the game. Kevin Kennedy alluding to the fact that right field with its nook and cranny actually tougher to play than the Green Monster, say some right fielders. Larry Walker certainly will know that when he defends. That was well played by Trot Nixon to hold Walker to a double.
And now it's Albert Pujols. What a regular season, what a postseason Pujols has had. Hit 500 in the NLCS and was the MVP for St. Louis. He got the game tying double against Roger Clemens in game seven and scored the winning run on Rowland's home run with the Cardinals hanging on to defeat Houston. Walker at second, one out. Pujols takes ball two, 2-0. We talked to Tony La Russa before the game and asked him if they had any clues as to try to hit a knuckleballer like Tim Wakefield. He said, well, we've got a couple of things, but we'll wait for about 10 days before we reveal them. Pujols, 2-1.
The one thing that you must do, whether you're catching the butterfly or hitting it, is to wait as long as you possibly can. Wait, wait, wait. Doug Mirabelli has to wait. Albert Pujols has to wait. And the home plate umpire, Ed Montague, has to wait to call it.
Pujols pops it up. It's a big out for Wakefield as Bellhorn takes it in, two out. Let's look at how Boston covers the field with tonight's Red Sox defense, brought to you by State Farm. This is a team that has committed only two errors in the entire postseason. One in the ALCS that belonged to Manny Ramirez in left, and there are no surprises, especially behind the plate with Wakefield on the mound. It is Mirabelli. Two out, runner at second, Walker, and here's Scott Rowland. Popped up left side. Bill Miller. Getting over. Wakefield works a scoreless first. Red Sox coming up. The World Series on Fox is brought to you by Chevrolet. 10 new cars and trucks in 20 months. There's a movement at Chevy. By Citi, credit card and financial tools to help you live richly. And by America Online. Want a better internet? You belong in America Online. Couple of 38-year-olds hooking up here in game one. Wakefield, now Woody Williams for the Cardinals, who has been fantastic since Walt Jocketty acquired him on August 2nd, 2001. Since that time, Tim, an ERA of 3.53, fifth best in the National League. And he's been good so far this postseason.
He started and won the LDS, and he started and won the LCS against Houston for St. Louis.
And now the WS?
And now the WS.
First pitch is up and away, ball one to Johnny Damon. Wakefield got around the Walker double. Damon takes it on the outside corner. 1-1. You know the story with Johnny Damon. Could not find his swing at all in the ALCS until, conveniently for the Red Sox, game seven. Strike two on Damon.
Let's take a look at the scouting report on Woody Williams. A combination of power and finesse. That's unusual. Actually, left-handed batters didn't do nearly as well as right-handers. And that strikeout with two strikes like right now inside. And that's what he was trying to do.
2-2.
There's that tailing fastball like Greg Maddux, who has mastered that pitch with two strikes. Maddux, another fine year with the Chicago Cubs.
Damon out in front, pulls the foul. You saw the numbers, the three hits, the two home runs in game seven of the ALCS at Yankee Stadium. A grand slam, then a two-run shot. Behind the tremendous pitching of Derek Lowe, the Red Sox took care of New York. Here they are in the World Series. That missed the inside corner, full count. For Woody Williams, he makes his sixth career postseason start. 3-1 overall, 2-0 this year. From Houston, Texas, he brings it, and Damon spoils it. This is more of Johnny Damon than what we saw in the first six games of the ALCS. Battling, trying to work a walk, trying to get on base any way he can for the Red Sox.
Game two at Yankee Stadium, when he had the 16-pitch at bat in the sixth inning against John Lieber.
Damon rips it foul. 10th pitch of this at bat to start the night coming here. What an at bat. Down the left field line, and Damon will dig for two. Taguchi gets to it. It's a leadoff double for Johnny Damon.
An exquisite at bat by Johnny Damon. 92 strike hits, led the major leagues. No one protects the plate like Damon. Fastball away, he hits it away for a double to start it off for the Red Sox.
Now it's Orlando Cabrera. Dave Roberts is already pumped up. Dave Roberts may have traveled the most important 90 feet of the ALCS for the Boston Red Sox. Cabrera up there to bunt, and it's foul. This Boston Red Sox team, that is so rare. Only 12 sacrifice bunts the entire season. That's the second lowest total in the history of Major League Baseball. It's just not something that Terry Francona and the Red Sox like to do.
Well, Cabrera coming over on the trading deadline on the 31st of July, and he gave the Red Sox another option. He's an excellent bunter.
Showing it again, he takes strike two.
But that is highly unusual to see the Red Sox bunting, particularly in the first inning. Sometimes you'll sacrifice the first two or three pitches, lure the pitcher into the strike zone so you can get a fastball to hit hard the other way. We'll see if he changes here.
Woody Williams needs a strikeout. Abandoning the bunt, and that's ball one.
What Cabrera's done with the bunt attempt, he's moved Albert Pujols in. Pujols on the ground, and now Albert moving back. It's that cat and mouse game. You hear about it with the pitcher and the hitter, rarely between the first baseman and the hitter.
Cabrera's hit, and that caught him, looked like, up around the face.
I think it may have hit two spots, Joe. Perhaps the left shoulder and then the helmet. I don't know.
Another look.
Everybody booing here, but that's the last thing that Woody Williams wanted to do. It did hit him on the tip of the left shoulder.
It may have caught him on the jaw on the way by.
May have.
So it's a double, a hit batsman. And once again, we give you tonight's starting lineup for the Red Sox, brought to you by Citibank. Damon, he's doubled. Cabrera's hit by the pitch. Now it's Manny Ramirez and David Ortiz. Millar, Nixon, Miller, Mirabelli, and Bellhorn.
Woody Williams trying to come inside, and here Cabrera trying to sacrifice, failed to do so. So instead of a runner on at third and one out, the Red Sox with runners on at first and second and nobody out.
And the dangerous Manny Ramirez at the plate. Ramirez did not drive in a run in the ALCS. Tony La Russa trying to position this defense. Brings the right side of the infield in a couple of steps. Ramirez takes ball one. In his career, Ramirez just a .246 career hitter in the postseason. 2-0 from Woody Williams.
To give you an idea about how balanced this Red Sox ball club is, they win the LCS against the New York Yankees without Pedro Martinez winning a game and without Manny Ramirez driving in a run.
And it took the entire 25-man roster for Terry Francona to figure out a way night after night to win four games against New York. The 2-0 pitch is popped down the right field line. Walker into the corner, going to get it. Long run, nice play. And the runner at second, Damon, will go to third. It's first and third, one out. Larry Walker covered a ton of ground.
Because he was playing Manny Ramirez into right center field. A Gold Glover. Now he has the fence with which to cope. He makes a quasi basket catch, slams into the wall, and holds Cabrera to first base. Damon properly a third of the way, goes back to tag up and goes to third easily. Nice play as Larry Walker is tested with the nooks and cranny of right here at Fenway.
Seven-time Gold Glove Award winner sets up first and third, one out for Senor Altuve. As they're calling him here now in Boston. The MVP of the ALCS takes ball one. Hit 387, three homers, 11 RBIs against the Yankees, and those were his numbers overall in the postseason. One clutch hit after another for the Red Sox. Down the right field line, into the corner. It is fair and a three-run home run. Ortiz has done it again. One into deep left field, back at the monster. It is off the green monster. Taguchi plays it well, but it's a double for Millar. Ortiz wasn't even in the dugout by the time Millar was sliding into second.
Looked like a slider to David Ortiz over the foul pole. My goodness, what a blast. Down and in. Oh.
We take a look at it down the line. Clearly a fair ball. Then the double by Millar, and now Nixon takes the ball inside.
Actually, that ball was to the left of the foul pole, but had it been online, it would have been over the foul pole. My goodness.
Here's a 1-0. Nixon pops it into right. Walker back. Two out. Walker throws toward third, and Rowland almost lost it in the lights. As Millar tags and goes to third, two down. Take a look at how St. Louis covers the field with tonight's Cardinal defense, brought to you by State Farm. Taguchi gets the start in left. Reggie Sanders is the DH for Tony La Russa. Edmonds and Walker. Edmonds has had a lot of opportunities in center field at Fenway Park. Rowland, Renteria, Womack, Pujols with Matheny catching Woody Williams. And here is St. Louis and Bill Miller. from DeSmet High School in St. Louis. Lifelong Cardinal fan and now a guy who last year won a batting title for the Boston Red Sox. And has come up with some key hits over the last couple of seasons for Boston. No hit bigger than his game four ninth inning tying base knock up the middle off Mariano Rivera. That set the wheels in motion. The Red Sox never looked back. The 1-1. Miller grounds it fair past third. It's 4-0. Millar comes in to score as Bill Miller knocks in his second run of the postseason. Last year's American League batting champion. Another slider from Woody Williams just inside the bag at third base. Plates the fourth Red Sox run here in the first inning. So the inning continues for Doug Mirabelli, the number eight hitter. Strike one. Eddie Montague is tonight's home plate umpire. He's the crew chief. Called strike one on that first pitch to Mirabelli. Good start for Boston. Oh and two. Mirabelli lost his bat on that swing. Woody Williams, an 11 game winner during the regular season. He won eight of his last 11 starts. Came into this World Series start holding opponents in the postseason under a 200 average. But the Red Sox have popped him here in the first. Mirabelli strikes out. But Boston comes up with four. Another home run by Ortiz. Thank you, Theo. A reference to Theo Epstein, the general manager of the Red Sox, as Edmonds bunts. And what a good play, and why not? Bill Miller is way over in the shortstop position. The third baseline was wide open, and Edmonds said, if you're going to give me a hit, I'll take it.
Absolutely. He almost squares around here. If it was bunted harder, it might have been a double.
Number 16, Richard. You see that shift so often, and I think just about every baseball fan, intense fan or casual fan, sometimes wonders, why don't they just drop one down that line and take a hit? Jim Edmonds, with his team down by four in the second inning, did just that. And here's Reggie Sanders, tonight's DH for Tony La Russa. Sanders takes a strike. The Red Sox 6-0 this postseason when they score first. And they got four runs in the first inning highlighted for the home run by Ortiz. Started to talk about that sign. Said thank you, Theo, and that was in reference to Theo Epstein bringing David Ortiz to the Boston Red Sox after he was cut loose by the Minnesota Twins. And the Twins got rid of him because he didn't have enough power. He was more of a line drive type hitter, so the Red Sox picked him up. He had a great year last year, even better this year, and the Red Sox have locked them into a long term deal. Here's an 0-2. Sanders takes ball one.
We were talking about it in game seven of the ALCS. David Ortiz may be the best bargain in Major League Baseball. Making a little over $4 million a year. Not chump change now, don't get me wrong, but still a pretty good deal on today's market.
It was 0-2, now it's 2-2. There's Theo Epstein, the 30-year-old general manager of the Boston Red Sox. The guy on the mound is 38, Tim Wakefield, who made his major league debut in 1992 at Three Rivers Stadium for the Pirates against the St. Louis Cardinals. Pitched a complete game 3-2 win. In October of 92, he won two games in the LCS. That's foul. The Red Sox picked him up well before Theo Epstein. Signed with Boston in 95 as a minor league free agent. And he has done a little bit of everything so far in his Red Sox career. Started long relief, set up relief, and even closed for a short time. That pitch in the dirt. Edmonds had wandered too far and is able to get back.
What a play by Doug Mirabelli. My gosh. That about a 56-foot knuckleball. Watch him come up with this ball. He smothers it. Edmonds saying, ball in the dirt, I'm running. Uh-oh, put on the brakes. He would have been out at second base. Fine play by Mirabelli.
Sanders with a full count gets back in. Sanders hits it foul, just foul down the third baseline.
Jim Edmonds was not running on that 3-2 pitch. Not a good running situation. You're trailing by four. You have Reggie Sanders, who strikes out a lot at the plate. And Wakefield could strike out anybody.
The Cardinals will run when they get the opportunity, however, against Wakefield. Because of the pressure that knuckleball puts on a catcher. Now, after the bunt hit, a walk to Sanders, the Cardinals are getting something going in the second. Here's Tim Wakefield, his 10th year in Boston, happy to help bring the World Series to Fenway.
It's going to be the coolest feeling ever. After playing here for 10 years and being in some postseason stuff, to be able to bring a World Series to the city of Boston for the first time since 1986, gotta say a lot for this organization and a lot for the city. I mean, the fans have been supportive of our team, or the teams that I've been on for the past 10 years, and just to be able to bring a World Series to them means a lot to me personally and a lot to the organization and to the city.
Womack showing bunt, takes the ball up and away as he pulls Bill Miller in at third. Millar is charging from first with Matheny on deck, and then the number nine man, so Taguchi. Cardinals trying to jump right back in it, down 4-0. One ball, one strike.
Tony Womack's natural stroke is down the third baseline. So he can hit the ball with authority, so it makes sense to bring the third baseman in. And when you do, and you're the hitter like Tony Womack, you try to slap it by the third baseman.
Pulled it back late. They want an appeal. No swing. Says Chuck Merriweather. He said that Womack pulled the bat back before offering at this pitch, and it was close. So the count's 2-1. See if the Cardinals stay with the bunt. And it's bunted hard enough to Miller at third. His throw, good play. Sacrifice is good, 5-4. The runners advance to second and third, one out.
That's not that odd a play, even though you're trailing by four runs. You figure if the Cardinals could drive in the two runs, it cuts the score in half. But the extra chance is that Tony Womack can get a base hit out of that. When you get the third baseman to barehand the ball, you've done what you want to do. So even though he gets a sacrifice, he was bunting for a base hit also.
Here's Matheny now, second and third, one out. No RBIs in the NLCS for the Cardinal catcher. Five in the division series. He takes a ball. Everything that we have said during the regular season and in the postseason for Jason Varitek applies to some degree for Mike Matheny with the Cardinals, with the kind of leadership he provides and the job he does behind the plate. One ball, one strike. It's Mirabelli tonight, but the Red Sox feature Varitek. And there's not one pitcher on this Red Sox team that wouldn't do anything they could for Varitek, and the same can be said for the Cardinal pitchers about Mike Matheny. Here's a 1-1. Strike two. Matheny hits it in the air to center. That's well hit. Damon is back near the track. Both runners tag, both advance, and it's 4-1. So a bunt hit, a walk, another bunt for a sacrifice, and now a sac fly. That is a National League run at its best here in Fenway Park.
A bunt by Edmonds, a walk to Reggie Sanders, a bunt by Womack, and a sacrifice fly by Mike Matheny. Both runners tagging. Reggie Sanders realizing that with the knuckleball, it's important to be on third base.
So Taguchi, strike one. Taguchi in the lineup tonight for Tony La Russa, as much for his defense and playing left field, tough left field with a green monster. Playing the caroms out there, dealing with a left field corner as he is in there for his offense. Checked his swing, a ball and a strike. The designated hitter used only in the American League home ballpark. So when this series goes to St. Louis, the pitcher's hit. Taguchi out of the way, two balls and a strike. Edgar Renteria on deck. Two and two on Taguchi.
Second fastball of the night thrown by Wakefield. No way do you want to get behind to Taguchi. So he surprises him with a fastball. If you're a Cardinal hitter like Taguchi, you can't be surprised when Wakefield throws a fastball.
Runner at third, two out. Taguchi checks his swing into a foul ball. Still two and two. Bank of America is proud to support the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund, helping families of military personnel who've given their lives in the current operations in defense of our country. As the official bank of Major League Baseball, Bank of America will donate $10,000 to the fund for every home run in the World Series. They have already kicked in $10,000, compliments of David Ortiz and a first inning three run homer. Then a double by Millar, and he scored on an RBI hit by Miller. Here's a 2-2. Taguchi strikes out. And that's the second of the night for Wakefield. The Cardinals are on the board. In the second, Bellhorn, Damon, Cabrera coming up for Boston. Providing aerial coverage for tonight's broadcast is Liberty, the AmeriQuest mortgage ship. AmeriQuest Mortgage, the official mortgage company of Major League Baseball. Down below at Fenway Park with the blimp right overhead, you can hear the blimp, that droning on noise that can be heard at the ballpark and at home with all the microphones we have in use tonight at Fenway as Bellhorn takes a ball inside, a ball and a strike.
You can hear the whirring.
Bellhorn saved his best for last in the ALCS, along with the guy on deck, Johnny Damon. Bellhorn, that huge three-run home run in game six at Yankee Stadium, and that's off the hands into left field for a hit. Taguchi gets to it, and Bellhorn is on to start the second. I think the wonder about the Red Sox was how would they come back after the couple of days off, after the emotional series against the Yankees, being down 3-0, fighting all the way back, becoming the first team in Major League Baseball history to do that in the postseason, to do it against the Yankees and at the end at Yankee Stadium. How would they come out in the World Series against the Cardinals?
I think that question's been answered.
Yeah, they've come out flying. 4 runs, 4 hits in the first, and a leadoff hit here in the second. Certainly for Terry Francona, not a question of, okay, we did that, now what? The objective for the Red Sox to win the World Series. And they're off to a good start tonight in game one. The 0-1 to Damon. Line drive to Renteria, one out. And the batter will be Cabrera.
Think about the circumstances in that first inning. After the Damon double, Cabrera was up. He tried to sacrifice on the first pitch. The ball hit fair, rolled foul. He was ultimately hit by a pitch. And after Ramirez flied to deep right, Ortiz had a home run, and then Millar with a double. Had Cabrera not been hit by a pitch, the scoring of the Red Sox would have been held down in the first inning.
One on, one out. Orlando Cabrera, good rip.
You don't know that when a team's trying to sacrifice and play for one run, but a lot of times in looking back over early innings, you're thinking, if you're the Cardinals, I wish the sacrifice had been successful.
Nothing in one on Cabrera, who hit in every game of the ALCS. Breaking ball missed low, a ball and a strike. Tim Wakefield through 2 innings. He's allowed 1 run as Cabrera hits it hard into left. Taguchi is there, 2 out. We recognize the excellent season of managing the Red Sox by Terry Francona, brought to you by Honda Pilot. Red Sox had a 44-37 record through the first half of the season, but had a torrid 54-27 second half, finishing with 98 wins. And Terry Francona, in his first year with Boston, has guided the Red Sox into the World Series, and it's the third time in the last 4 seasons a manager has led a team into the World Series in his first year. McKeon took over part of the way through last season, and Bob Brenly back in 2001 with the Diamondbacks. The first two successful in the World Series. As ball one misses low and away to Manny Ramirez.
Up and in, and the crowd ooing and eyeing because of Cabrera being hit by the pitch, and that went up and in to Manny Ramirez. With David Ortiz on deck, now think about it. There is no way you're trying to plunk Manny Ramirez.
2-1. There's David Ortiz, who now has 5 home runs this postseason and 18 RBIs. He finished the division series, Ortiz did, with a home run in game 3 against Anaheim. The extra innings, 10th to win it. A walk-off home run in the 12th, a game-winning base hit in the 14th against the Yankees. And he's going to get another shot with two on here in the second. Manny Ramirez is on. And now David Ortiz will get saluted as he comes to the plate.
Slider and a good piece of hitting by Manny Ramirez. A lot of right-handed batters would be vulnerable to that pitch, but Ramirez, one of the truly talented hitters in baseball.
Now Dave Duncan, the pitching coach for St. Louis, will come out and remind Woody Williams of what they're trying to do with David Ortiz at the plate. You just look at the postseason numbers for Ortiz. A 4.42 average, 5 home runs, the 18 RBIs, he scored 11 runs, 3 game-ending hits. He got the game started in Game 7 at Yankee Stadium with a 2-run homer in the first. Started Game 1 tonight with a 3-run shot as Dan Heron gets loose for St. Louis in their bullpen. Ball 1. Bellhorn and Ramirez the runners. Two and oh. Infield swung way around to the right. Three and oh.
See how loosely David Ortiz holds that left hand. Ted Williams used to say that hitters don't tighten up until contact. You hold the bat very loosely. You cradle the bat in the crook of the fingers between the fingers and the palm of the hand.
On 3-0, Ortiz was going to let it fly if he liked it. That's ball 4. The first walk of the night by Williams, and that loads him up for Kevin Millar. .44 pitches already for Woody Williams, and Millar, who took the first pitch delivered to him in the first inning for a double high off the green monster, digs in with the bases loaded, 2 out. Millar has hit .342 here at Fenway Park this season. Strike 1. Bases loaded, 2 out. Millar takes ball 1. The Cardinals in the third inning will have the top of their lineup: Renteria, Walker, and Pujols. Williams trying to keep it a 3-run game. The third for Rowland will go to the bag and a scoreless long second inning for Woody Williams. Third inning now at Fenway, 4-1 Boston.
The winner takes it all, the loser standing small. Beside the victory, that's a destiny.
First pitch is a strike to Edgar Renteria. Third inning underway, 4-1 Boston. Just missed a chance to add to this lead. Renteria, Walker, and Pujols for St. Louis. 1-1. A little ABBA for you. You like that, don't you?
I like it a lot. The winner takes it all.
Here's a 1-1 pitch. Renteria takes low.
Okay, maybe it's first. All right, so we can take this up in here or what?
On 2-1, Renteria grounds left side. We showed you those programs, and these two teams, as I mentioned earlier, have gone head-to-head in the World Series before 1946. The Cardinals won in 7. Same in 67. Harry Burkeen was 3-0 in 46 with a 0.45 ERA. Ted Williams hit only 200 in that series. Bob Gibson 3-0 with a 1 ERA in 1967. And Yaz hit 400. And Yaz threw out the first pitch here tonight. Walker, strike one.
Carl Yastrzemski going 0 for 4 in game 1 of the 1967 series. And after that game, after 163 games.
That ball is down the right field line. If it's fair, it's gone. It is gone. A home run for Walker. And it's a 4-2 Boston lead in the third. Walker has hit two knuckleballs tonight. One for a double and one for a home run. And it's a two-run game here in the third inning. Wakefield during the regular season allowed 29 home runs. That was tops on this Boston Red Sox staff, and Walker gets him here in the third inning. Here's Pujols. Strike one.
Larry Walker, acquired by the Cardinals on August 6th, had 11 home runs. And hits one here.
One ball, one strike. Staying inside the pole down the right field line as Pujols takes in the dirt 2-1.
About in the same area that David Ortiz hit his. Not quite as far, but far enough.
That's low, 3-1. Pujols popped up his first time up. Full count. Pujols hit by the pitch, and he's on with one out here in the third inning.
Hit with a curveball before that home run, talking about Carl Yastrzemski, who was 0 for 4 in the first game against Bob Gibson. And after 163 games, he had the grounds crew bring out the batting cage, and he took extra hitting as Cardinal players watched. And the next day, Yaz went 3 for 4 with 2 home runs and 4 runs driven in. Yes, sir. T-shirts were being sold outside Fenway 37 years ago.
And that gate area out in center field is where the batting cage disappears to after BP is over. One on, one out here. Roland got a pretty good swing. Strike one. Scott Roland, for much of the season, led the National League in RBIs until he tore a calf muscle and missed 16 games in September and lost his lead in the RBI race. Still finished second with 124. A strike on the inside corner. It's 0-2.
Good knuckleball that stays inside to Roland.
Renteria grounded out. Walker homered. Pujols hit by a pitch, and now Mirabelli digs it out of the dirt. I was just thinking today, you know, we saw Veritek, who's such a good catcher, struggle so much trying to catch Wakefield in the extra innings here the other night. You think about the eye-hand coordination on the part of Doug Mirabelli to be able to pick up these pitches and catch them. Really lets you know all you need to know about the kind of ability Mirabelli has behind the plate. Still 1-2.
Jason Veritek in the 13th inning of game 5, three pass balls. No spin is good spin when it pertains to the knuckleball. When it starts rolling, that's the worst thing that can happen. Hitters pick that up very easily.
Another foul. Jason Veritek will tell you how hard it is to catch the knuckleball. And he was happy that as that inning came to a close with the go-ahead run at third base, he was able to hang on to a third strike on Ruben Sierra. And not let yet one more trickle away to put the Yankees on top. Another foul. Here's Veritek.
It's like snowflakes. There's no two that's the same. And it's like, you know, sometimes it's like catching a fly with a chopstick. So, but it's fun. It's so gratifying when you catch him. He does well. And because it's so far away from an element, any element you could have grown up practicing.
That's just high to roll in two balls, two strikes.
Notice he said trying to catch a fly with a chopstick.
Yeah.
Only one.
Right. I mean, two is hard enough, as Mr. Miyagi taught us many years ago, but one. Here's a 2-2, one on, one out. Roland grounds to third. Miller. An inning that features a home run by Larry Walker. Bottom of the third inning, game one in Boston, 4-2 Red Sox. And welcome back to a ballpark that opened in 1912. Fenway Park, game one of the World Series. Trot Nixon first up for the Red Sox, who lead it by two. A visit with Tony La Russa is to follow this at bat by Nixon, and then later we will visit with Terry Francona. Both managers agreeing to visit with us briefly during tonight's game. Here's a 1-0. One ball, one strike. Nixon flat out to deep right his first time up. Nixon, Miller, and Mirabelli. 6, 7, and 8 in the lineup for Boston. On the inside corner, strike two. This Boston Red Sox team, the course of the season, scored one full run more per game here at Fenway Park as opposed to what they did on the road. Nixon is out, one down here in the bottom of the third inning, and moments ago we had a chance to visit with Tony La Russa, manager of the Cardinals. We'll just talk quickly, Tony, about the two starters. First of all, Woody Williams had that rough first inning. What'd you see?
Well, I'm seeing him get a lot of balls up, and he had a lot of problems in the second inning. You know, that last out, he got to Malaga, the ball down. That's where he's got to pitch.
On the other side, Tim Wakefield, that knuckleball seems to be dancing from time to time. How about from the viewpoint of the dugout?
Well, I mean, he's got a lot of movement. He's got 60 pitches, so we're making him work, and I mean, I feel good about how we're going about him. So if we can hold him down, we're going to be all right.
Tony, thanks for the time.
All right.
One out here in the third inning, and the batter is Bill Miller. Took a ball. Now a strike.
One ball that Woody Williams did not get up was the slider to David Ortiz. That ball stayed down. We have seen what David Ortiz could do to that pitch. That ball down and in. He is lethal. Here it is one more time. You can see Matheny setting up inside. He doesn't miss that pitch. He'll pull it foul occasionally.
Whew. 1-2, the count on Bill Miller. 2-2. Up and down this Red Sox lineup, you've got one hitter after another so much better hitting at Fenway Park this season. And overall, Bill Miller is a lifetime 333 hitter here in Boston. That just missed. It's a full count. On 3-2, Miller draws a one-out walk. And if that is the case, and the Red Sox are so much more dangerous offensively at home than on the road, think back to the All-Star game in Houston. Home run by Manny Ramirez against Roger Clemens. Later, a home run by David Ortiz. Two members of the Red Sox, and who knew back in the middle part of July in that game in Houston that those home runs, one by Ramirez, one by Ortiz, would help get the home field advantage for the American League, and in this case, the Boston Red Sox.
That is a very interesting point and right on the money.
Miller, a belly at the plate to check on the runner at first. Cardinals had Danny Heron getting loose in their bullpen last inning. No action there at the moment. Strike one on Mirabelli. You want to look at all the stats, home and road. The difference in the record, the runs per game, the team average, and the doubles. One on, one out. The 0-1 pitch on the outside corner. It's 0-2 on Mirabelli. Mirabelli's a guy who during the regular season got only 160 at bats but hit 9 home runs and slugged over 500. He made the most of his chances and he spoils an 0-2 pitch from Woody Williams.
Doug had the highest slugging percentage for catchers with 175 plate appearances or more. Slugging percentage, total bases divided into times at bat. So he's not just a guy who catches every fifth day. He catches a knuckleball.
See the kind of rip he gets even with a count of no balls and two strikes.
Yeah, he is a good strong hitter. And so is he.
The other guy we show you is Jason Varitek. Switch hitting catcher in his last year under contract for the Boston Red Sox, and there are quite a few on that list. Another 0-2 pitch. Mirabelli hits it into left field. Well hit off the wall. Taguchi plays it off the wall, throws into second, and it's first and third, one out.
So Mirabelli hits it high off the 37-foot wall in left field. Nicely played by Taguchi. That ball had a little more elevation. It's gone. Ball's a home run in a lot of ballparks. The monster does take away occasionally also.
Bellhorn takes the ball inside. Mark got a base hit the opposite way on a jam shot in the second inning. Red Sox loaded the bases last inning. Did not push a run across. At first and third, one out here. Bellhorn checked his swing. It's 2-0. Danny Heron starts to get loose for St. Louis again. With runners on, Bellhorn during the regular season hit 301. 2-1. Runner at third is Miller. Runner at first is Mirabelli. The 2-1. 3-1 with Johnny Damon on deck. hard hit. And it's a full count, and that was barely fouled. Dale Scott is the first base umpire.
A good look at it right here. If it goes over the bag and lands foul, it's a fair ball. And that came very close to going over the bag and landing foul, but a good call by Dale Scott as it hooks right before it got to the first base bag.
So it's 3-2 now on Bellhorn. 82 RBIs during the regular season. For this postseason. And the bases are loaded. Ron Jackson is the hitting coach for the Boston Red Sox. Here's his reaction. He wears a mic on that hit by Mirabelli. He agrees with you. That ball was launched and put yet another dent in the Green Monster. Some facts about the Green Monster, in case you haven't seen many games from Fenway Park. 37 feet tall. Painted green in 1947. 310 down the left field line. Changed from 315 in 1995. They added seats in 2003. Keep trying to add as many seats to Fenway Park as they can. And after the season is over, they will dig up this entire playing field. Try to get a better drainage system here at Fenway Park. And that wall next season might be 38 feet tall. As they're going to dig down into the surface here at Fenway. Bases loaded, one out. Damon hits it. Foul.
That's what Woody Williams has to do right now. Dig down deeply. Because he is in a ton of trouble. You have a contact hitter up. You have a guy that doesn't hit into too many double plays. And you have Dan Heron warming for the Cardinals.
Base hit, Damon. Miller scores. Mirabelli is held at third. And the Red Sox add to their lead. It's 5-2. And that could be it for Woody Williams.
I would think so. Dan Heron warming up last inning is loose. And Tony La Russa is going to the mound.
So Woody Williams can't get through three innings in this World Series start. It's 5-2 Boston, looking for more. Bases loaded, one out. Woody Williams had waited a long time to start a game in the World Series. Came in this postseason 2-0. He lasts 70 pitches and only 2 1/3 innings, 5 runs on 8 hits, and he's responsible for all 3 runners on. And he gives way to the 24-year-old right-hander Dan Heron. Spent the majority of the season at Triple-A Memphis. And here he is in the World Series, game one, taking over with the bases loaded, one out, facing Orlando Cabrera. Into left field, a base hit. One run scores, that's Mirabelli. They hold Bellhorn, and that makes it 6-2.
The last two balls were hit so hard that Dale Swain, the third base coach, could not score the Red Sox runners. The Damon single to right field, and now Cabrera to left field. It's especially difficult to score runners when your left fielder plays as shallow as Taguchi does, forced because of the Green Monster in left.
Now it's Manny Ramirez with the bases loaded, one out. Mirabelli in the game to catch Wakefield, and he is right in the middle of this third inning rally. With a hit, now a run scored. Ramirez, strike one. Manny tonight is flied to right and single.
Red Sox have that carousel working here in the third.
The top run producing team in the American League taking on the top run producing team in the National League. And the Red Sox have good speed on the bases. Strike two on Ramirez. Dan Heron, who led the Pacific Coast League in strikeouts, needs one here. Red Sox have their four-run lead back and a chance for much more. Left side, Renteria in the hole to second, out, no other play. A run scores, it's 7-2.
To the right of Edgar Renteria, Orlando Cabrera, middle infielder himself, going in hard at second base to make sure that Womack doesn't complete the double play as the Red Sox score another tally.
We saw Cabrera do that a couple of times in the ALCS. One time he drilled Miguel Cairo, the second baseman of the Yankees. That's the first RBI for Manny Ramirez since game three of the division series. And David Ortiz takes low ball one. Four runs in the first inning and three more here in the third for Boston. The 1-0 to Ortiz is wide, 2-0. Nicknamed Poppy. Sign of respect for David Ortiz and the crowd chanting, "Who's your poppy?" He's already hit a three-run homer and walked. He's on his way to another walk. It's 3-0.
Yeah, Poppy popped one his first time up. Three-run home run, prodigious blast. His nickname is Poppy, and yet he's the third youngest player on the Red Sox roster. He's only 28 years old. It's a young Poppy.
A four-pitch walk. Ortiz on base for the third time tonight. The ninth man to bat in the inning is Millar. Bases loaded, two out. Millar with a double and a run scored, and he's bounced into a force out. Takes a strike. Dan Heron features a fastball that comes in at over 90 miles per hour and a very good split finger pitch. Shattered bat. Renteria. Millar is gone. So are the Red Sox. But three more runs. Boston has come out firing here in game one, leading it 7-2. The World Series on Fox is brought to you by Bud Light. Fresh, smooth, real. It's all here. And so far, it's been pretty much all Boston. 7-2 after three innings. Red Sox have chased the St. Louis starter Woody Williams, and here is Jim Edmonds. Smart play for a bunt base hit his first time up, scored a run, driven in by Matheny, and he leads it off. Fourth inning, takes a ball. Cardinals led the National League in team average and total runs as they try to figure out Tim Wakefield. He finds a strike. It's 1-1.
A lot of teams do this to Edmonds. They have three infielders on the right side of the infield, and yet out in center field, Johnny Damon is straight away. That's because Edmonds has power to all fields in the outfield, but when he puts the ball in play on the ground, he has a tendency to pull the ball.
Here's a 2-1. 3-1. The bunt base hit by Edmonds his first time has pulled Bill Miller in over at 30. Still well off the line. But he is in, I would say, a good 4 or 5 steps from where he was back in the second. Here's a 3-1. A leadoff walk. Moments ago, we had a chance to visit with Red Sox manager Terry Francona. Terry Francona, thanks for the time. So far, so good tonight. This is a fantastic start for your team. Were you worried at all with the emotional series against the Yankees, how your guys would come out?
You know what? Not really. That was such a big series. But, and I've told so many people, our guys just love to play baseball. And this atmosphere at Fenway is so awesome. It feels like we've played about 90 playoff games this year.
Kind of odd. It's got to be odd, Terry, with a big lead early in a ball game.
Well, it's just, there's a lot of baseball left, but it is definitely a lot easier to play with a lead, especially with a team that likes to run a little bit and has some speed. But we got a long way to go.
You like what you see from Wakefield so far?
Yeah, he's doing okay. And, you know, the wind wasn't necessarily in his favor when this game started, but he looks like he's got a pretty good knuckleball, and he's commanded so far. So far, so good.
Terry, thanks for your time.
Okay, guys.
Terry Francona, manager of the Red Sox, a leadoff walk by Wakefield. And now that one gets away, and Edmonds will go down to second base. Count goes to 2-0, and it certainly goes without saying as we look at this one just elude the glove of Mirabelli. In the category of a pass ball, albeit a tough one, with the knuckleball coming his way. We really appreciate the two managers agreeing to join us for those little interviews during the ball game. And certainly Tony La Russa and Terry Francona don't have to. We asked, they both said yes. And we're happy to share those interviews with you. It's all because they said okay. 2 balls, no strikes.
You'll get something other than a knuckleball here.
And it's high for ball 3. Right on the heels of Terry Francona saying so far so good with Wakefield commanding that knuckleball, he has walked Edmonds. And he's 3-0 on Sanders.
Even high with his fastball, he walked Edmonds on a fastball, went to 3-0 on a fastball.
Back-to-back walks. Back-to-back high fastballs. And 3 walks now on the record of Tim Wakefield tonight. 2 on. Nobody out. Tony Womack is walking to the plate. First knuckleball pitcher to start a World Series game since 1948 is Tim Wakefield. And he is the first Boston Red Sox starter to start and open a World Series here at Fenway Park since Louis Tion beat Cincinnati 6-0 in 1975.
Joe, you had an interesting comment before our opening while we were in commercial. You were looking at Wakefield warming up and just happened to mention to me that he is the opposite of a drop and drive pitcher. He has that straight right leg, which makes it good for a knuckleball, but then when he tries to throw the fastball, a lot of times he can't drop and drive and it stays high. And that's what's happened on the last 2 hitters.
See how the Cardinals want to play it. They had Womack bunt in a similar situation his first time, but here the Cardinals bat in the 4th inning down by 5. So a much different situation, though the Red Sox expect it.
Yeah, you don't do that here.
Where Miller is and Millar over at first. Bronson Arroyo getting loose.
You're going to pinch Womack anyway, pinching toward home because he has set speed. But no way to the Cardinals' butt in this situation.
And all of a sudden, Wakefield can't find a strike anyway. So why, if you're the Cardinals, would you give Boston and Wakefield a free out?
You got to take right here. Make Wakefield get the ball down in the strike zone.
Here's a 2-0. 3-0. And now Wakefield stares in and Ed Montague, the home plate umpire.
Pitch looked high.
A 3-0 delivery. 3-1.
You love it as a hitter in this situation because you know you're going to get a fastball. Wakefield trying to take advantage of the 5-run lead.
And that's 3 walks to open the 4th. A And the Cardinals could climb right back into this game as Millar goes over to the mound to talk to Wakefield with Matheny coming up. Matheny has an RBI and a sac fly back in the second. And here is an opportunity for St. Louis to do some big damage. The Red Sox try and hurry Bronson Arroyo along out in their bullpen. Ball one inside. Wakefield right now feels like he's getting squeezed. Ball one strike.
Sticking with the knuckleball and a dandy. Two guys missed it. Matheny and Mirabelli.
Ed Montague, the home plate umpire, did not. Here's a 1-1. There's another strike. 1-2. Crowd back in it. Bases loaded. Nobody out. Two and two. Edmonds a runner at third. Sanders at second and Womack on at first. The 2-2. Full count. 15 pitches out of the strike zone in the inning, and only four strikes out of the hand of Tim Wakefield.
I think Trot Nixon's too deep in right field. Matheny does not have power the other way and has a tendency with two strikes to dump balls in front of the right fielder.
Foul.
Matheny, a guy with two strikes who feels for the ball outside. And when you feel for the ball outside and you do hit it the other way, you don't hit it with a lot of power.
Ken Boyer, the last grand slam. The bet against the Yankees in 1964.
And Al Downing.
Bases loaded, nobody out. Matheny pops it into shallow right. And Nixon is there. Edmonds is coming to the plate. The throw's cut off. Millar bobbled it and throws it into the dugout. Two runs are going to come home on the play, and Tony Womack is going to end up at third base. It's a 7-4 game. Womack is at third. The throw was cut off by Millar, and then he couldn't get it out of his glove.
He actually had a shot at Reggie Sanders had he thrown it cleanly out of his mitt. Sometimes that mitt is so big that it hangs up in there. Trot Nixon does his job. He hits the cutoff man, and Millar's throw is errant. How many times on a sacrifice fly do you score two runs and send another runner to third with less than two outs?
It's a sac fly to right, E3. And the error sends Womack to third, Taguchi at the plate, one out. First pitch of ball. Now a ground ball to third. Miller couldn't get it out of his glove and throws to first instead. That produces a run, and it's 7-5.
That's a great base running play by Tony Womack, who was about 4 feet inside the line running home. And Miller figures, well, I've got a three-run lead. Watch Womack come inside the line, and Miller has to think twice before he goes home, goes to first, and the Cardinals have another run. Outstanding base running by Womack. He knew Miller had a shot at him, So he ran inside the line, well inside the line, and scores the Cardinal field run.
All of a sudden, it's a two-run game here in the fourth inning as the pitch is low to Renteria. You can see that little clutch by Bill Miller over at third base. The question is, could he not get it out of his glove? Did he not get a good grip? Or did he just rethink and then throw on to first?
I think he rethought it because he realizes the Red Sox have a three-run lead. And why take a chance? Because when you throw home on a ball like that, Mirabelli's setting up inside, there's a pretty good chance you could hit the runner.
3-0 now to count on Renteria. Edgar Renteria will tank and take a strike. A 3-1. Another walk. That's the fourth of the inning, and that is it for Wakefield. Lost it in a hurry. Four walks in the frame, five on the night. The Cardinals are back in the game, have the tying run coming up, and Bronson Arroyo coming out of the pen. Bronson Arroyo was in the starting rotation for Boston in the division series and in the LCS at the beginning. Found his way into the bullpen, was effective against the Yankees, and now it's low in the rotation. Arroyo in the bullpen, and it's Arroyo in the game here in the fourth inning, game one. Tying run at the plate, Larry Walker, who's 2-for-2. Renteria picked up the fourth walk of the inning, fifth of the night from Wakefield, to extend the inning, and Walker gets his third hit of the night. Renteria will turn and go to third. It's first and third with two out, and Albert Pujols is coming up.
Well, it is said that you can't give a major league team four outs in an inning or they'll come back on you. You also can't give an offense as powerful as the St. Louis Cardinals a chance to get back by walking four in an inning. And that's what Tim Wakefield did. And now the Cardinals taking advantage of it with their big gun up and two on.
Albert Pujols, 14 RBIs this postseason, six home runs. Runners at the corners, two out, ball one. Renteria on at third, Walker on at first. Walker is doubled, homered, and singled. Only in the fourth inning, Pujols takes a strike. Temperature in the low 40s, upper 30s. Wind whistling around Fenway Park. 7-5 Boston. 2-1 on Pujols. Steven Tyler, who sang the Star Spangled Banner before tonight's game, did a great job now watching. Native of Boston, as Albert Pujols waits for a 2-1 pitch coming his way. Off the end of the bat, Cabrera. The inning is finally over. But the Cardinals have climbed back into it. They get three in the fourth inning. It's 7-5. Bottom of the fourth at Fenway Park. Trot Nixon first up for the Red Sox here in the bottom of the fourth. It's 7-5. We came on the air talking about what this series might be, a high scoring series, a lot of runs. And we would have to wait and see which bullpen could hang on to and nail down leads for victories. And we're already into the bullpen on each side as we play in the fourth inning. We've had a total of 12 runs on 13 hits. That's ball three, 3-0 on Nixon. pitch. Nixon, Miller, and Mirabelli. Three and one. Aaron, who figures to be a big part of the St. Louis rotation next year, out of the bullpen, finds the outside part of the plate. It's 3-2. Still full. We've already heard from the Red Sox hitting coach, who's wearing a microphone, Ron Jackson, and the DH for the Cardinals, Reggie Sanders, is wearing a microphone tonight as Nixon fouls it back and out of play. And there was an interesting verbal exchange in the top of this fourth inning that we'll play for you as soon as we get the chance. Nixon is fly to right, grounded out. Still 3-2. The Boston Red Sox, who won 5 of the first 15 World Series play. Back in the World Series for the first time since 1986. They lost to the New York Mets. They lead tonight, game one, as Nixon is in a battle with Danny Heron. This for Boston, their 5th World Series since they sold Babe Ruth to the Yankees. And the previous 4, it's gone to 7 games. 3-2 pitch, a leadoff walk. Nixon had to work for it. Here's the exchange between Reggie Sanders of the Cardinals and Orlando Cabrera, the shortstop of the Boston Red Sox.
I know you probably wasn't trying to throw elbows, but it looked like you was trying to throw elbows at second.
That was that slide, and that left elbow came up. Reggie with a warning to Orlando Cabrera.
That's in the category of a polite way of saying, yeah, don't do that again.
Yep, it is.
And it's something that we saw Cabrera do against the Yankees on 2 different occasions. One time catching Miguel Cairo, the second baseman from the Yankees, flush, knocking him down.
Yeah, the reason you don't want to do that is you're a middle infielder yourself. The old what goes around comes around.
1-1 on Bill Miller. Miller tonight, an RBI single, a walk and a run scored. Pretty piece of hitting back in the first. The runner at third, 2 out. He took a pitch the other way and drove him in. That was against Woody Williams, knocking home Kevin Millar. On deck is Mirabelli.
Yeah, Bill Miller, a guy that Terry Francona loves to hit and run with. And the 2-1 count is the ideal hit and run count.
Nixon stays put. Miller fouls it away. 2-2. Red Sox got 3 in the bottom of the 3rd. The Cardinals answered with 3. 3 runs and only 1 hit in the top of this 4th. 2-2. Full count. Nixon running. Miller fouls it at the plate.
See that little move, that little turn in. Bill Miller, like all hitters, reminding himself to keep the shoulder in. See hitters do that all the time. Just a little mental reminder.
Another 3-2, Nixon runs, ball four, back-to-back walks. To start the fourth inning, and let's check in with Chris Myers.
Joe, I'm among the people. You talked about the fan base of these two teams. The Green Monster seats here at Fenway, an assortment of Red Sox fans. 86-year-old Sam, you've waited a long time for this.
Positively.
You were here for what, the 46?
1946 World Series. I caught the first ball coming from here in Slada.
All right, well now, and also, Therese has come. Where are you from?
Sweden.
And you're a Red Sox fan?
A huge Red Sox fan.
Your family?
My family, all the way from Sweden. They love the game.
All right, and how about we have 3.5-year-old Ethan here, and you a big Red Sox fan?
Yeah.
How big, Ethan?
This big.
Really huge. All right, Joe, back to you.
All right, Chris, that's great.
Chris Myers on top of the Monster, two on, nobody out. Mirabelli flies into left field, and Taguchi hauls in out number one. So Heron has put himself in a tight spot. And he gets the first out. Now it's Bellhorn walking to the plate.
That young lady from Sweden, I would imagine Sweden would have a very short baseball season.
Oh, yeah.
With the weather up there. More like Sweden than it is Boston tonight.
We've already heard from ABBA tonight.
Yeah, right.
They're from Sweden, right?
Mamma Mia, of course.
Two on, one out. And a ball in the dirt, smothered by Matheny. Bellhorn has been on base twice tonight. With a single, a walk, and a run scored. During the regular season, set a Red Sox record with 177 strikeouts. Here he pops it up. Long run in for Walker. Out goes Womack. And it's Walker who makes the circus-like catch. He didn't know if Womack was going to come out anymore, and Walker at the end has to lunge to make the play.
Walker starting from deep right field, respecting Mark Bellhorn's power. He had trouble with the wind, it looked like there.
And now with two on, two out, here's Johnny Damon, who's hit the ball hard in three at-bats. He's doubled and scored, lined to short, and has an RBI single. Ball one low. I learned from you as a young man sitting at home watching you broadcast a World Series that you can't see the wind.
No, you can't.
See the effect of the wind.
Yes. You don't watch the wind.
No, you can't.
You can't.
2-0 on Damon. You remember that?
I don't remember saying that, but I know I've said it. I don't remember what year.
Whistling in, straight in from center field. A 2-0. Damon takes a strike. 91 miles per hour from Heron. Those two runners were on with nobody out. They're on with two out. Damon chased it. 2-2.
That looked like a splitter. Yep, it was. That's the dead spin that hitters are used to seeing. So on a fastball count, a good splitter from Heron.
Damon pops it up, shallow left field. And so Taguchi will haul it in. Heron put the first two on, gets around it. Rolling, two up for St. Louis. Two-run game after four, back after this. From your local station. It's a 7-5 Boston lead. Into the fifth inning we go. Scott Rowland first up for St. Louis takes a strike. Bronson Arroyo starts the fifth inning fresh, came on in the fourth. Gave up a hit to Larry Walker and then got Pujols. The tying runs on to end the top of the fourth. Rowland to Cabrera. One out here in the fifth inning. Coming up tomorrow, it's Fox NFL Sunday. Doubleheader, game one, the Lions and the Giants. Cowboys at the Packers. Good way to end the football day on Fox. It all begins at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific. Broadcast in Fox Sports high definition. And then it's us from Fenway Park, game two of this World Series. A long day of sports on Fox tomorrow as Edmonds takes a strike. Edmonds has walked and scored and rolled out a bunt hit and scored a run. Did that back in the second. One out, nobody on. Edmonds. 0-2.
Well, Arroyo appears to be locked in. A good fastball to jam Scott Rowland. And now after the fastball, a good breaking ball to get Edmonds in the hole.
And I think it's what Bronson Arroyo showed out of the bullpen. The extra inning affair here at Fenway Park against the Yankees, and then what he did in game six. I mean, you cannot underline enough the job that Bronson Arroyo did in the eighth inning at Yankee Stadium on Tuesday night. Schilling had gone seven innings, allowing one run on four hits. And Arroyo took the ball next, and in the eighth inning, did give up a run. Kept it a two-run game, and that's how it ended, thanks to the terrific work of Keith Fulk. That forced game seven. Edmonds is gone, two out in the fifth.
Fastball, breaking ball, fastball. On the outside part, gets Edmonds.
You can play Hit the Pros, presented by the all-new GMC Canyon, and face real pitches from today's best hurlers. Log on to FoxSports.com on MSN. Keyword games. GMC, we are professional grade. With two out, nobody on, Reggie Sanders, the polite. Reggie Sanders stands in and pops it up. Into right field, Nixon coming on, the wind pushing it. And it just threw that ball out of play. Strike one instead of out number three.
Todd Nixon drifting, and that ball about seven or eight rows back.
Reggie Sanders this year became the first player in Major League history to hit 20 or more home runs with six different teams. For a guy that's bounced around as much as Reggie Sanders has, you think, well, he must be a bad guy. A problem in the clubhouse, and he is the opposite. Signing a two-year deal with St. Louis over the offseason, so he at least knows where he will call his baseball home next year. Here's a 1-1. Backing out of play, strike two.
Reggie, a very good low ball hitter, and National League pitchers try to pitch him above the hands because of his penchant to carry those hands lower than most hitters.
A 1-2 to Sanders, 2-2. This was by far the best year in the big leagues for Bronson Arroyo, who used to pitch for the Pirates. And he really grew on manager Terry Francona to the point where he got the ball in game three of the division series. Pitched well against the Angels. bullpen blew the lead. And Sanders is bailing on strike three. A 1-2-3 frame. Manny Ramirez due up at the bottom of the fifth for the Red Sox. What's the difference between me and you? Providing aerial coverage for tonight's broadcast, Liberty, the AmeriQuest Mortgage ship. AmeriQuest Mortgage, the official mortgage company of Major League Baseball. Red Sox at one point led by as many as five. Now it's 7-5, bottom of the fifth inning. And Orlando Cabrera first up. Cabrera, Ramirez, Ortiz. Strike one from Herron. We've got around back-to-back walks to start the fourth inning by getting Mirabelli, Bellhorn, and Damon. One ball, one strike. Tony La Russa was behind Terry Francona in announcing his rotation for the rest of this World Series. We'll give that to you. 1-1 pitch. Late swing by Cabrera. He was fooled. Strike two. It'll be Matt Morris and Curt Schilling tomorrow night in game two. Pedro Martinez and Jeff Supon in game three in St. Louis. Derek Lowe and Jason Marquis in game four. Here's a 1-2 pitch. Cabrera bounces it on two hops to Renteria. A happy man, Manny Ramirez, is coming to the plate. If you're on his team, be prepared to be hugged. Keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for. In good times, in bad times, I'll be on your side forevermore. Oh, that's what friends are for. Dionne Warwick. Ball one down and in to Manny Ramirez.
Stevie Wonder has never sung to a handshake like Kevin Millar and Manny Ramirez. I tell you, that thing takes some practice.
Here's a 1-0. Two balls, no strikes.
Red Sox about as unconventional a group of guys as you will find. Have fun playing the game, and as Terry Francona says, they love to play baseball.
That's a fair ball. Hits the umpire after bounding off that extra billboard down the left side, a photographer's well. It came out and caught Jerry Davis, but it goes as a single either way.
And that ball is in play. Once it goes by the infielder and hits the umpire, it is a not only a fair ball, but a ball that is live. So Jerry Davis just staying there, retrieved by Taguchi, and he holds Ramirez to a single.
Here's David Ortiz, one on, one out. Ramirez got around first, saw that happen down the left field line, and was caught as Ortiz takes a strike. He thought about going down to second, then hesitated and ended up retreating back to first base. Our Budweiser fantasy players are Albert Pujols and David Ortiz, MVPs of the recent LCS action. Ortiz goes after that splitter. It's 0-2. You can log on to foxsports.com on MSN, keyword fantasy baseball. Tonight's game brought to you by Budweiser. Grab a cold fresh Budweiser. It's game time. No balls, two strikes, one on, one out. Ball one. Back in the first. 3-0 Boston. Home run number five of this postseason. 2-2.
American League pitchers try to crowd David Ortiz with high fastballs, but he's so strong that he can fight that ball off and put it in front of deep outfielders or outfielders playing deeper.
Jammed there and a fly ball into left for Taguchi. Two outs. You know, we had those quick little visits with the managers. If you think back to the interviews, Tony La Russa said, the pitch count from Wakefield is getting up. I like our chances if we can hold them down. And then right after that, three-run bottom of the third inning. And at the time, it was 7-2. Then Tony La Russa's offense got to Tim Wakefield. He lost control of his pitches. He walked four in the top of the fourth inning. Right on the heels of Terry Francona saying he liked the control up to this point by Wakefield. He lost control. He gave up three runs. It became a 7-5 game in the span of six outs. And it's still 7-5 in the bottom of the fifth.
I think even Tim Wakefield tonight would say that Tim Wakefield got to Tim Wakefield. The four walks.
One ball, one strike on Millar with one on, two out. Bottom three in the order coming up for St. Louis in the sixth. Womack, Matheny, and Taguchi. A 1-1. Strike two. -46. 67. 75. 86. And now 2004. I think somebody got a foul ball into a beverage. Got splashed down to our right. The count still 1-2 on Millar. The pennant winning 46 Red Sox. Meanwhile, the Cardinals have 9 world championships, but they're enjoying their first pennant since 1987. They haven't won the World Series since 1982. Millar hits it to third. Roland picks it up. Guides it across, and the inning is over. We go to the sixth inning. The State House here in Boston. It's 7-5, Red Sox after 5. The World Series on Fox is brought to you by GMC Trucks and SUVs. We are professional grade. By AmeriQuest Mortgage, the company that knows you are more. And by Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade, is it in you? Bronson Arroyo goes back to work. Joe Buck, Tim McCarver, our producer Pete Macheska, our director Bill Webb, here at a very cold Fenway Park. And it looks like Bronson Arroyo, Mr. Gloved One, has got his A game coming out of the bullpen here early for the Boston Red Sox.
He really does. He looks locked in, and he might be the only person in this stadium who is wearing a t-shirt pitching with a bare right arm. Normally pitchers wearing the long sleeve woolen shirts under that uniform, but not Bronson.
Family from Cuba. As Womack hits it in the air to right, Nixon has to go back, adjust and get it. One out. One down, and Matheny will be the hitter.
Tony Womack normally does not have that kind of power to the outfield.
Here's Matheny. Bronson Arroyo's father, an immigrant from Cuba, was on dialysis, needed a kidney. And Bronson Arroyo offered his father one of his. And his father refused it. Didn't want to take it from his son, and his mother, Bronson's mother, a nurse, had a co-worker. There was a match there. The co-worker, friends with Bronson's mother, donated the kidney to Bronson Arroyo's father.
Wow, what a great story. Wow.
Matheny keeps it 0-2. He's named after the actor, the late Charles Bronson, has taught Kevin Millar how to play the guitar, and as a kid had a pitching mound in his backyard. Interesting delivery. As Matheny strikes out, two down. It's almost a, can I say this, Tim, pretty leg kick by Bronson Arroyo, like he's a member of the Rockettes.
Yeah.
Bringing it to the plate.
I talked to Bronson before the game. He grew up in Key West, Florida. Spent a lot of time there as a kid, and he was telling me that next week it's Fantasy Fest in Key West, Florida, where people parade around in body paint only. That's what's happening in Key West next week, and I'm beginning to sound like Willard Scott.
Yeah. I don't know that Willard's ever talked about Fantasy Fest. As that makes it 0-2 on So Taguchi. When's that, next weekend?
That is next week, yes. But that is, it's a high leg kick. It's a kick he doesn't use from the stretch.
Willard could find somebody that was turning 100, participating in Fantasy Fest, then Willard
that would
Scott
be
would have something to talk about.
That would be a story, yes.
With a name like Mabel, she's got to be pretty. Here's an 0-2. Slow roller, Bronson Arroyo. Off balance, throws it away, and that will send Taguchi down to second with two out. It'll be a base hit, E1 on the throw. And so a team, the Red Sox, that committed only one error the entire ALCS, has two here tonight.
Yeah, there are two plays that the Red Sox are thinking again about. The one play by Kevin Millar, where he threw the ball in the dugout, and this play by Bronson Arroyo. Bronson should have kept that one. It trickles in the dugout, or the camera well, near the Red Sox dugout. Theo Epstein is not at all pleased about that.
So the tying run is at the plate. Sixth inning, 7-5 Boston. Runner at second, two out. Renteria playing in his second World Series. Part of the champion Marlins in 97. And you can see the effect of this breaking ball on these right-handed hitters. Sanders was bailing on a pitch that was called strike three, and Renteria was trying to get out of the way of a pitch that just missed.
Yeah, if your first step as a hitter is to go back on your heels, then the pitcher's got you.
A 1-0. Strike one. On deck is Larry Walker. He's already 3-for-3 tonight. The 1-1. Renteria does not look comfortable at all facing Arroyo. The count's 2-1.
Arroyo dropping down. You can see when Renteria goes back on that heel, the front heel, and that's not generally a good sign for the hitter.
He went. It's a 2-2 count.
Four breaking balls in a row to Renteria. And again, back on the heels.
It would be shocking to see Arroyo throw anything but a breaking ball here.
I agree with you.
Arroyo came in the fourth. Pitched a perfect fifth. Got the first two here in the sixth. A chop base hit down the third baseline, then the throwing error has Taguchi at second, two out. Here comes a 2-2. Renteria lines it into left center field. It's a one-run game. That ball goes all the way to the wall, and Renteria is standing at second. It is 7-6 here in the sixth.
And Arroyo does go to the breaking ball, but he hangs it. A slider that backs up and stays over the middle of the plate. Rifled by Ramirez in left field. So five straight breaking balls. The problem with that is that fifth one's got to be a little better than the first one. And Arroyo hanging that pitch. It shows you right now the problem with the throw to first base. I think Bronson wishes he had held on to that ball. Then you have second and third, perhaps. Second and third, it's still a two-run ball game.
America's number one pregame show's back, and tomorrow they take a look at the Jets' best start in franchise history and their attempt to end the Patriots' streak. Plus, we'll break down the Packers' chances to get back into playoff contention. Warren Sapp goes 10 yards with Terry Bradshaw. Fox NFL Sunday returns tomorrow, noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific on Fox, as Mike Myers, a left-hander, and Mike Timlin, the right-hander and former Cardinal, get loose in the Red Sox bullpen. Here's Walker, and the Cardinals are a hit away from tying this game. That is a fair ball. That's going to tie the ball game as Trot Nixon goes to get it down the right field line. It's 7-7, and Walker is 4-for-4. Three straight two-out hits, and the Cardinals have come back to even it.
And four straight hits for Larry Walker. Two doubles, a home run, and this ball right by the diving Millar. Kevin tried to keep it on the infield, but it just squirts by the glove, and the Cardinals have tied it. The double by Renteria. He scores easily on the double by Walker.
More two-out runs, something the Cardinals have done throughout this postseason. They beat the Dodgers that way, and they made a lot of noise against the Astros with two-out runs. During the postseason, 61% of the Cardinals' runs have come with two out. Both runs here in the sixth inning to tie it. Breaking ball is strike two to Albert Pujols. Just in case you were wondering, no one has ever hit for the cycle in the history of postseason baseball. Walker is a triple away and came pretty close right there. Ball one, low and away. 1,107 games. No one has hit for the cycle. Right now, Pujols is trying to knock home a run and give the Cardinals their first lead of game one. Two and two. Albert Pujols, one of only three in the history of Major League Baseball to average 125 RBIs his first 4 years. The other two, DiMaggio and Ted Williams. The 2-2 pitch to Pujols. Over. Cardinals get two-out runs in the sixth inning. As we go to the bottom of the sixth, bottom of the order coming up for Boston, it's 7-7. Trot Nixon up there hacking on the first pitch, bottom of the sixth inning, a 7-7 game. The Cardinals trailed 7-2. After three innings, they got three runs in the fourth, two more in the sixth. Larry Walker has been at the center of all of it. And Nixon first up here in the bottom half of the sixth. One ball, one strike from Dan Heron. Nixon, Miller, and then Mirabelli's spot, but Jason Veritek has come in from the bullpen and could pinch hit. If Terry Francona wants to go that way in the bottom of the sixth. Two balls and a strike on Nixon. There's Veritek. Certainly he'd be the hitter with one on or with two on. With two out and nobody on, maybe not. 3-1 on Nixon. Six home runs for Nixon during the regular season, a season that started with a bulging disc in his back and a terrible quad injury. And on a cold night, he has to leg it down to first as Heron makes the play. One out, bottom of the sixth inning, and once again, Chris Myers.
Joe, the wind has picked up a little bit, blowing in from center field, and actually in between innings I walked by home plate. Right in that area it seems to swirl a little bit more, and it's getting colder. The temperature's dropped about 10 degrees since the start of the game, and I asked the Cardinal equipment manager before the game how they packed for New England weather like this. He said long johns, hand warmers, and red stocking caps. That's red stocking caps, no red socks.
Thank you, Chris. That would be Rip Rowan, Cardinal equipment manager, taking over for the great Buddy Bates. One ball, no strikes on Bill Miller. On base all three times tonight. Low from Heron, 2-0. Miller with an RBI single, a walk and a run scored. He walked again in the fourth as these Red Sox hitters face Heron for the second time. Miller able to check his swing. It's 3-0.
You mentioned Bill Miller, a St. Louisan, and he wears the number 11. When he was 11 years old, he was in the stands in the nosebleed section when the Cardinals won their last world championship back in 1982. There with his dad.
Cardinals beating Milwaukee that year, 3-1 pitch. Full count.
Harvey's Wall Bangers. Harvey Keene, the manager. And did they ever have a power-laden team? Cecil Cooper, Ben Ogilvy, Gorman Thomas, Robin Young, Paul Molitor.
That's slapped foul. Still 3-2.
Ted Simmons.
Timlin is ready to go for Boston. Seventh inning, it'll be Roland, Edmonds, and Sanders for St. Louis. Miller with one out, nobody on. Pops it into left center field, and Edmonds is back. Two down. Get the new MLB Authentic Collection Premier Jacket and wear what the players wear. The MLB Authentic Collection is available on MLB.com or at 888-MLB-SHOP. Clothes make the fan. And here is Veritek pinch hitting in the sixth. Okay, I'm going to say it right now. This is, I think this move is in at least approaching the category of curious with two out, nobody on, the way Mirabelli handles the bat. Certainly Veritek is a guy that can pop the ball out of the park.
Yep.
But with the situation on the bench, Veritek could come up in a key spot later in the ball game, more of an RBI situation. One ball, one strike.
Yeah, and as you look down the lineup, who would he pinch hit for? The most likely guy he would pinch hit for is Doug Mirabelli. So if that's the case, why not hit him now?
With two out, nobody on, here's a 1-1. He tried to check his swing. He didn't. According to Chuck Merriweather, the third base umpire, and Veritek's in the hole, 1-2. So Heron has been behind each of the first two hitters, come back to get him, and now he's out in front of Veritek, 1-2.
I think as importantly, you run out of runners. In other words, if you kept Mirabelli in there, then you could pinch run for him later, and Veritek is still in the wings. Veritek's the last catcher. The Red Sox only carrying two catchers.
Yeah, and that was really more the point that I was getting at, in case something were to happen to Mirabelli on a cold night.
Yep.
Now you've got Veritek. Something happens to Veritek, Mirabelli's gone.
That's right.
Here's a 1-2. And the inning is over. We go to the seventh inning. Middle part of the order coming up for St. Louis. 7-7 game. Back after this from your local station. Third pitcher of the night for Boston is Mike Timlin. Bronson Arroyo, so good until he got two outs in the top of the sixth inning. And then what started the trouble for St. Louis? Just a little chopper hit down the third baseline that Arroyo threw away. Then back-to-back doubles by Renteria and Walker. And Arroyo ends up giving up two runs on four hits. So now in the seventh, in a 7-7 game, we remind you this February, Fox takes center stage for two of sports' biggest events, the Great American Race, the Daytona 500, and the NFL crowns a new champion in Super Bowl 39. Sports' greatest moments continue to unfold this February only on Fox. Jason Veritek stays in the game. He does the catching. And as we move into the seventh inning, Scott Rowland is digging his way in. He's 0-for-3. The top two run producing teams, one from each league, hooking up in this World Series as Rowland strike one. And the last time that happened, where the top run scoring team from the AL met the top from the NL, the 75 World Series between Boston and Cincinnati. And that series went all seven. 0-2 on Rowland, with Calero continuing to loosen. The Red Sox in the bottom of this seventh will have Bellhorn, Damon, Cabrera. Rowland, three home runs in the NLCS, takes high. Rowland hits it in the air to center field for Damon. One out in the seventh. Should it surprise anybody that we are here in game one between these two teams, and it's 7-7. You compare these two, the Cardinals and Red Sox. Cardinals first in average in the NL, the Red Sox second in average. Third in home runs with the Cardinals, fourth with the Boston Red Sox. And here's Jim Edmonds, who's been on base twice. Edmonds fifth in the National League with 42 home runs. Pops it up into left for Manny Ramirez. Two out. In walks Reggie Sanders. Sanders, two walks, a run scored, and a strikeout.
There are a lot of different reasons and a lot of opinions about why the Red Sox are here. In my view, the Red Sox are playing the first game of the World Series here at Fenway Park because of their bullpen. Their bullpen was extraordinary against the New York Yankees the last four games.
And it was the same group night after night as Millar digs it out and saves a throwing error from Timlin. A perfect seventh inning from Mike Timlin, and we will stay right here at Fenway Park as we move toward the bottom of the seventh. All servicemen and women currently stationed across the globe
we welcome the winner of the 2002 American Idol competition on Fox and platinum recording artist Kelly Clarkson, who will now lead us in this evening's presentation of God Bless America.
God bless America.
Thank you, Kelly Clarkson. The World Series on Fox brought to you by Honda, the four-wheel drive, 255 horsepower Pilot built by Honda, by John Hancock, official sponsor of Major League Baseball, and by Warner Brothers' new motion picture, The Polar Express. The journey begins Wednesday, November 10th. We're into the bottom of the seventh inning. Game summary is brought to you by John Hancock. Woody Williams could not get through three. Tim Wakefield could not get through four, the two starters. Ortiz, a three-run shot in the first. Larry Walker, 4-for-4. And the Red Sox have blown what was at one point a five-run lead, 7-2. It's 7-7. And here is Mark Bellhorn, the number nine man, against the third pitcher for St. Louis, Kiko Calero. Calero has blossomed into a valuable right-hander out of the bullpen for Tony La Russa. He and Julian Tavares provide the main setup relief for Jason Isringhausen. From the right side, Ray King is the only lefty available in the bullpen now for Tony La Russa as Steve Kline was left off the World Series roster, and Al Reyes, a right-hander, was added. Here's a 2-0 to Bellhorn. 2-1.
That's how much obvious respect the Cardinals have for David Ortiz. They have Ray King warming up to pitch to Ortiz, who could be the fifth hitter in this inning if the Red Sox get anything going.
Three balls and a strike.
Come on, kid.
Full count. It's a big loss for St. Louis to not have Steve Kline available. Tore a groin muscle late in the season, then a tendon, having trouble in his index finger on his pitching hand. It was a very good 1-2 punch from the left side of the bullpen for La Russa this year. A leadoff walk. Good start to this seventh inning for Boston. Seventh walk handed to the Red Sox tonight. And here's Damon.
Johnny Damon tried to bunt against the New York Yankees with two runners on in game six and popped it up. He is a very good bunter, and that statistic we used earlier, only 12 sacrifices on the year. It'll be interesting to see what Terry Francona opts to do here. Normally you would bunt. Damon with good speed could bunt for a base hit, or he could wait until the count's in his favor and put the hit and run on.
Cardinal bullpen had the top ERA in the National League this season. One on, nobody out. Not showing bunt, takes a strike. Terry Francona, the manager for the Red Sox, played predominantly in the National League, long time with the Montreal Expos, for a short while with the St. Louis organization, and managed in Philadelphia. But not bunting here in the count, zone two on Damon. 11 o'clock straight up on the scoreboard here at Fenway Park. Game one of this World Series. And a matchup between the St. Louis Cardinals and the Boston Red Sox. Tonight, that big trio of Pujols, Roland, and Edmonds, 1 for 10. Yet a 7-7 game, bottom of the seventh. Ball one to Damon. Orlando Cabrera next. Then Manny Ramirez and Ortiz. Ray King ready to go. Time call. That look is because of the leadoff walk. Handed out to Bellhorn. Damon waits for a 1-2. Shattered bat. Womack has only one play, and like a bunt, Damon advances the go-ahead run down to second. One away. Cabrera coming up.
As good as a bunt, but with a bunt, you save a bat. Damon shattering the bat and not hitting it hard enough to Womack at second to get the force play. Normal speed.
He's lost a lot of bats this postseason. Here's Orlando Cabrera. He has hit very well for the Red Sox in a couple of different spots in their lineup this postseason. And a hit. It put Boston back on top. Ball one.
Tell you, if I were a hitter on the Boston Red Sox, I would plead with the manager to hit me second, because you know that a pitcher is not going to pitch around you. He's going to find the middle part of the plate with Ramirez and Ortiz coming up.
Cabrera pops it up back behind the plate. Messina out of room.
You are going to have your pitches to hit if you hit second in this lineup.
And you can plead, but you also have to earn your way into that spot, and Cabrera's done that.
Absolutely.
It was Bellhorn earlier in this postseason. Now it's Cabrera up in the number two spot. And what a golden opportunity for Orlando. Two balls and a strike. Opposing hitters talk about Kiko Calero, and they put him in the category of those pitchers that hide the ball very well. And all of a sudden, a 90 mile an hour fastball looks like 94 or 95, and they have a tough time, the right-handers do, connecting with his breaking ball. The 2-1. Three balls and a strike.
Yeah, aside from having a good arm, that could be the most valuable weapon a pitcher has. It's how he looks to a hitter. And if you can't pick the ball up, he appears to have better stuff than he really has. In the hole here to Cabrera.
Go ahead, run at second, one out, 3-1 pitch. Two on, one out. Two walks. And that will bring Dave Duncan out of the dugout. So with two on, one out, Manny Ramirez is coming up. David Ortiz will be standing in the on deck circle, and we look ahead to tomorrow night. World Series game two. 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific. And a matchup of Matt Morris and Curt Schilling. A couple of guys who hooked up in a great division series game back in 2001 for the Cardinals and the Diamondbacks.
And during the introductions tonight, predictably, Curt Schilling with the biggest ovation of the Red Sox.
Where will he fit in the sports history of this city if the Red Sox should go on to win this World Series with what he did in that game six start at Yankee Stadium? Right now, it's Manny Ramirez dealing with Kiko Calero. Two on, one out. Tie game, seventh inning, ball one. Schilling had the sutures put in today. Extra one, four stitches. Try to hold that tendon in one spot. Looking ahead to his start tomorrow night on his right ankle. Ramirez with a base hit into center. Edmonds will come up throwing. The throw is wide. The other runners advance. They have Ramirez between first and second, able to get back to first. And the Red Sox have regained the lead. It's 8-7.
Slip the cheese by Manny Ramirez. A low fastball hammered to center. And one run scores. Outstanding base running by Orlando Cabrera and a very poor throw by Jim Edmonds. The throw to second base, but nobody's back at first.
Kiko Calero walks two, gives up a run. Manny Ramirez delivers for the Red Sox in the seventh. Manny Ramirez went the entire seven-game ALCS without an RBI. He has two tonight, and his reaction after putting the Red Sox back in front in the seventh.
Well, nobody's covering first because the right side of the infield collapsed toward the center. And when Mike Matheny made the play on the throw from Jim Edmonds, there was nobody covering first. Pujols tried to get over there, but Ramirez retreated to first base.
So now it's Ray King dealing with David Ortiz, and these two should face each other a number of times during this World Series. Ortiz takes ball one inside. Ortiz with a three-run homer and a pair of walks is one for two. Hard hit, and that comes up and catches Womack. In to score is Cabrera. Stopping at second is Ramirez. It's 9-7 Boston, but Tony Womack caught that up around the collarbone of the throat.
Trainer Barry Weinberg rushing out. Hopeful, and the Cardinals are hopeful that it's on the muscle on the left side, like the shoulder area. That ball with a wicked hop. I think it's going to be scored as a base hit. Another run scores. Boy. Looked like it hit him on the clavicle. That area right above the
He's already been dealing with terrible back spasms.
that forced him to leave game six of the NLCS. And on this cold night at Fenway Park, Tony Womack has yet to really stretch that left arm out and see how far he can go with it. Womack's trying to walk it off. It's an RBI base hit, and watch how fast this ball came up and caught Tony Womack.
Hit very hard. Looked like the breastbone area right below the throat, perhaps to the left, right in the clavicle area. Man.
And Womack is going to exit. Marlon Anderson will come in the game and take over at second after this. So Ortiz has a four RBI night. And here are the Gillette Mach 3 Power home run hitters for the 2004 postseason. Beltran leads away with eight from the Astros. Pujols six, Ortiz with five, including his shot in the first inning tonight. And Walker has five and one tonight as well. So hopefully Womack is okay, and Marlon Anderson takes over with Millar coming up.
Keep in mind that you cannot make a replacement during the series. If Tony Womack is seriously injured, you can't replace him with another player.
It's a two-run Boston lead, 9-7 here in the bottom of the seventh. Two on with one out. And so far, it's the Red Sox winning this battle of the bullpens. Both hitters at Calero walked and come around to score. And Amilar takes a strike. Cal Eldred, a right-hander, is getting loose in the St. Louis bullpen. It's Millar now and a left-handed Trot Nixon on deck. Two on, one out. Millar takes strike two. The four RBIs tonight for David Ortiz ties a Red Sox World Series record. Stremski had four in game two in 67. In the top of the eighth, it'll be Marlon Anderson, Mike Matheny, and So Taguchi, the bottom three in the lineup for St. Louis.
Joe, it's funny how the game goes sometimes. If Manny Ramirez is on second base, Tony La Russa is forced to play his infield in with Ortiz hitting. And Womack gets a more predictable hop than he got at second base. Little quirky nuances of the game.
Still 0-2 on Millar. Two on, one out, and Millar goes up to get it and fouls it back. There's the situation right now. Woody Williams, the Cardinals starter, went 2 1/3, seven runs on eight hits. Heron, very good out of the bullpen, 3 2/3, no runs on two hits. But Calero has had two score against him here in the seventh, and he's still responsible for the runner at second, Manny Ramirez. On at first, Ortiz, in the 0-2 to Millar. That's foul.
See, if Ramirez is on at second base, had he made it to second, then Womack is more shallow. And the ball that came up to hit him in the left shoulder area would have been a more predictable hop. Now, you're not sure that Ortiz would have hit a ball like that, but had he, the Cardinals have a shot at home to cut off the run. But more importantly, Womack's not hurt.
Still 0-2 on Millar. Red Sox getting their first run since a three-run third inning. The 0-2. Millar tonight doubled in the first inning after the Ortiz three-run homer, and he scored on a two-out hit by Miller. Grounded out three times since. The 0-2. Another foul. Guy's on his toes.
Some play right there. Pickett Wilson.
A World Series moment of greatness for that guy down the left field line. And he is using a Wilson. Here's an 0-2. Ball one. King came on for Ortiz, and in their first matchup, Ortiz hit a rocket against the Cardinal left-hander. Popped up. Matheny in foul territory for out number two. For the latest on the Womack injury, let's go down to Chris Myers.
Joe, I just spoke with the trainer Barry Weinberg. He was walking with Womack, who was leaning over in excruciating pain. He took a shot in the left collarbone. That's where the injury is. They're taking Womack for precautionary x-rays at an x-ray room here at Fenway Park.
All right, Chris, thanks. There's Barry Weinberg. It looked like the last two times I've seen that replay, it glanced first off the right hand of Womack and then into the clavicle area. And as Trot Nixon is lifted for the pinch hitter, Gabe Kapler, Tony La Russa is going to go to Cal Eldred out of his bullpen here in the seventh. Fantastic 3-4 combination in this Red Sox lineup of Manny Ramirez and David Ortiz with the RBIs here in the seventh inning. And it's Boston back on top by two as Cal Eldred works in his fourth game of this postseason. Two on, two out, Kapler at the plate.
And it should be pointed out that if Manny Ramirez is running hard out of the box and not celebrating with his right index finger up in the air, he's on second base easily on the throw by Jim Edmonds home.
Strike one to Kapler.
Here it is again. Ramirez getting the hit. And then the throw by Edmonds way over the head of the cutoff man, Jim Albert Pujols. And Ramirez would have been in the second base easily, but he was celebrating and not running hard.
One ball, one strike.
Now he turns it on. And by the time he retreats, no one's covering first base.
On 1-1, Kapler takes outside from Eldred. Kapler came on to pinch hit. That chased King out of the game, and Francona likes to go to Kapler. A little more range in the outfield out in right. Red Sox now leading by two in the bottom of the seventh. The count evens at 2-2. Bottom part of the order coming up for St. Louis in the eighth. The 2-2 pitch to Kapler. Got him on the inside corner, and the inning is over. Two walks, two hits, two runs for Boston. They lead by two. We move into the eighth inning of game one. It's a 9-7. Boston lead. First up, Marlon Anderson. First pitch swinging. Two hopper. One out. Up above, providing aerial coverage for tonight's broadcast, is Liberty, the AmeriQuest mortgage ship. AmeriQuest Mortgage, the official mortgage company of Major League Baseball. Anderson's first at bat since taking over for the injured Tony Womack. Doug Minkiewicz is in the game at first base. Kapler stays in the game in right. And Timlin has retired all four Cardinal hitters he's faced. Here's Matheny, right back up the middle. And Matheny is on with his first hit of the night. His first World Series hit is against Mike Timlin, who we used to catch in a Cardinal uniform. And here comes Roger Cedeno off the bench to bat for Taguchi.
Number 32, Roger.
Alan Embry, the left-hander. Keith Folk, the right-hander, getting loose. And Jason Marquis, the Game 4 starter, is going to come on and pinch run for Matheny. Pretty sure, bet, Tim, that Marquis will not stay in and catch.
No. No, I think that's a reasonable comment.
Here comes Francona with Roger Cedeno, the switch hitter, coming up. Francona is going to go back to his bullpen. Takes the ball from Timlin. One on, one out. Tying run at the plate for St. Louis in the eighth. Alan Embry takes over for Mike Timlin. Eighth inning, one on, one out. And Roger Cedeno takes low ball one. Cedeno, the switch hitter, flips around and bats right-handed against Embry, who's done this in the postseason. Cedeno, two hits, eight at bats this postseason. One of those two hits huge for St. Louis in game seven. He got it off Roger Clemens in the sixth inning. And that was the inning in which the Cardinals came up with three runs to take a 4-2 lead, a game they won 5-2. One ball, one strike on Cedeno. Two and one.
Cedeno, a key guy, not only in this inning, but in this game. If he gets Cedeno out, then you can leave Embry in to pitch to Renteria. And the reason you do that is because of Larry Walker. Keith Folk, the stopper, warming for the Red Sox.
Runner at first, one out. And Cedeno floats one into right field. That will fall for a base hit. Marquis stumbling into second base, and it's two on with one out, and the Cardinals hope that Marquis, the game four starter, is okay.
That is always the problem when you put a starting pitcher in to pinch run. Jason Marquis, scheduled to go in game four, was the pinch runner for Mike Matheny. He stumbles right before he gets to second base. He appears to be all right. Keep in mind, he wasn't loose, but he's okay.
And now, because Cedeno reaches, the Cardinal lineup turns over. Renteria and Walker coming up. And Keith Folk, who was sensational in the ALCS, comes in. The tying runs are on here in the eighth. Once his teammates realized that he was not injured and okay after this adventure going from first to second on the part of Jason Marquis, his teammates were chuckling over in the dugout.
Jason on the treadmill to nowhere.
But he's all right. He's a lead runner at second. Cedeno is a trail runner at first. The tying runs are on, and Keith Folk who was the MVP of this very good bullpen in the ALCS, is in the game. Edgar Renteria first to face him. First World Series appearance for Keith Folk. He has been lights out his last 11 games. Misses high with ball one. Last 11 games, Folk has not allowed a run.
And only 5 hits.
And he's not the kind of closer that comes in throwing 97 miles an hour.
No, far from it. A good changeup and a high fastball, so he's not a guy who throws a lot of double play balls.
On the outside corner, a ball and a strike.
That's a terrible play. If Renteria is thinking about bunting, with the tying run on at first base, terrible play. If he wasn't thinking about bunting, why'd he look like he was bunting?
One ball, one strike. Strike two.
See, that's the thing. You even the count by acting like you're bunting, and now you're swinging a bad ball. Best chance for Edgar Renteria is to hit an extra base hit, or to get an extra base hit to score the runner who can run from first base in Roger Cedeno.
Renteria fouls it off to the right, and that will get out of play. Back-to-back hits, Matheny and then Cedeno. Marquis running for Matheny. Cedeno can run. He's at first. 9-7 Boston, top of the eighth inning. Game one, the World Series. 2-2. Folk went 6 innings over 3 days, games 4, 5, and 6, through 100 pitches over those 3 games. Here comes a 2-2 pitch. Renteria grounds a base hit into left field. Marquis will come to the plate after initially stopping the throw home safe, and it's a one-run game.
How in the world did Veritek ever hold on to the ball? Terry Francona, out to argue, looked like he had the plate blocked. Marquis had stopped at third base, and then by the time he resumed his path home, he runs right smack in the middle of Jason Veritek. Watch Marquis rounding third, given a stop sign by Jose Oquendo, the third base coach. Well, that was very, very close. Great play by Veritek. But a good call by home plate umpire Ed Montague. Looked like the foot was in there.
So now Folk has to deal with Larry Walker, who's 4-for-4. 2 on, 1 out. Strike one. The only 5-hit game, Paul Molitor back in 1982 in World Series play. Renteria delivers the hit, no RBI. They've given Ramirez an error on the play. 2 on, 1 out. Walker. 1 ball, 1 strike. Second error this postseason for Manny Ramirez. A 1-1 pitch to Larry Walker. On deck is Pujols. the protection in each lineup comes in this number two spot. Larry Walker up on the count even with his four hits, with Albert Pujols waiting to hit next. Polk has to come right after him, and Walker went after the changeup, 2-2.
That's the thing about Keith Polk. He can throw the off-speed pitch and fastball counts as good as any short reliever in the game.
Larry Walker into shallow left field. Ramirez coming on. Can't make the play. Cedeno will go to third and come around and score. Over to third is Renteria. And it's second and third, only one out, as Manny Ramirez has made back-to-back mistakes in left. Another error on back-to-back plays in left field by Manny Ramirez, who the last half inning was celebrating a go-ahead hit, and he just flat-out boxed it sliding into his right.
Yeah, this is a major league error right here. Manny Ramirez, ball hit the back of the glove as he tried to slide to make the play. A lot of left fielders do that. A lot of outfielders do that. Cedeno broke toward third, broke back to second, and now scores rather easily. The second consecutive error for Manny Ramirez, and now they'll walk Pujols.
This will load the bases. It's a tie game, 9-9. Pujols will go down to first, and it will be Scott Rolen at the plate. There is a mismatch defensively between these two clubs, even though the Red Sox made only the one error in the ALCS. And Manny Ramirez, his play in left field, has killed the Red Sox. It hits the back of his glove. And Ramirez's defense here in the eighth inning has crushed the Red Sox as two runs have scored. The bases are loaded, still only one out, and the Cardinals have come back yet again. Rolling now, bases loaded, one out. And a pop-up, big out for Folk. Infield fly rule in effect, two out. First 10 games of this postseason, only two errors total, four tonight for the Red Sox. And Ramirez has a couple of them. Here's Edmonds. Julian Tavares getting loose out in the St. Louis bullpen. The Red Sox have their closer in the game, trying now to keep it tied, 9-9. Bases loaded, two out. Edmonds, ball one. A 1-0. Edmonds trying to launch one. One ball, one strike. Edmonds and Folk battling. Cardinals have never led in this game. On the inside corner, strike two.
Good fastball following the changeup. Shreds the inside corner.
Eighth man to bat in the inning.
Folk has Edmonds set up. Got him on the inside corner. The inning is over. The Cardinals leave the bases loaded. They're helped to two runs, two errors by Ramirez in left. The World Series on Fox is brought to you by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge, by Neulasta. Ask your doctor how you can be ready with Neulasta. And by Walt Disney Pictures' National Treasure, coming to theaters everywhere November 19th. Jim Edmonds feeling as if he was robbed of at least one more swing in the top of this eighth, as this pitch from Folk was called by Eddie Montague, the home plate umpire, for strike three. And the Cardinals had a chance with the bases loaded, one out, didn't do any more damage. And that's how the inning ended. And Manny Ramirez, who had his spike catch out in the grass and left, committed two errors in the top of this eighth inning as the Cardinals have tied at 9-9. Watches Julian Tavares take over on the mound. Couple of defensive changes. Yadier Molina is his catcher. And Roger Cedeno takes over and left. The irony of it is, as you look at Cedeno, so Taguchi started this game because of his defensive abilities in playing the tough left field here at Fenway. The pendulum has swung the opposite way now with Cedeno, who struggles in the outfield, staying in the game, batting the number nine spot in left. As Miller takes ball two, 2-0.
Cardinals trailing by two runs, needed offense. Cedeno delivered with a key hit to right field and ended up scoring the tying run for St. Louis.
A strike, it's 2-1. Julian Tavares, who gave up a home run to Carlos Beltran in Houston in game four of that NLCS, went berserk in the dugout after giving up the home run. That's strike two. And after throwing stuff all around, started punching a phone and broke bones in his left hand. Miller grounds to the right side for Marlon Anderson. One out. Here is the Julian Tavares experience in game four. And then in game seven, dealing with Lance Berkman, that ended the top of the eighth. That ball hit him, obviously, in his glove hand, and he got a little chip coming off one of those fractures. And his hand will be in a cast for 8 weeks at the end of the World Series. With one out and nobody on, here's Veritek. Ball one. Chris?
Yeah, Joe, Julian Tavares told me before the game that pitching in that game seven of the NLCS, when he was trying to field the ball, it moved the bone over in his hand, so he needed additional shots, two shots on the top and two below on the hand, so he could be able to work tonight. And he said his father, who's watching down in Miami, who doesn't speak English, did tell him, take your anger out on the batter. And Tony La Russa may have had the best line after the outburst, and then after Tavares pitched well, he said, I guess even Sinatra has to clear his throat once in a while.
One ball, one strike, one out, nobody on. Veritek rounds to the left side. Renteria can't make the play. Shaded up the middle, couldn't make the play to his right. And Veritek is on with one out here in the bottom of the eighth.
Yeah, when an infielder goes to his right, the ball hits the heel of the glove, then you're finished.
Right off the heel and down, and we're awaiting on the official score to say hit or error. And it's an error on Renteria. 2nd the Cardinals, that is their second error in as many postseason games. Edmonds made a throwing error in game 7 of the NLCS, and those are their only 2 miscues of the postseason. 1-1, 1 out for Bellhorn. Strike 1. Whoever loses this game 1 is going to be able to look back at a game filled with opportunities to either take a lead or add on to the lead. It's 9-9. The Cardinals have never led. The Red Sox at one point led 7-2 after 3 innings. It's now 9-9 in the 8th.
Red Sox have stranded 12. The Cardinals have stranded 8.
A 4 error night for the Red Sox. 1-1, 1 out, no balls, 1 strike. Bellhorn hits it down the right field line. That ball is hooking foul. And once that got down the line, that hit a wall of wind that just grabbed it, stopped it, and looked like it almost pushed it back and well out of play. Oh, and 2, the count on Bellhorn. Ball 1. On deck is Johnny Damon, who's had a nice night with the bat. Field again down the line near the pole. Home run, Bellhorn. A 2-run shot. And it's 11-9 Boston in game 1. Takes ball 1.
That home run was a replica of a ball hit by Mark Bellhorn in game 7 of the ALCS against Tom Gordon.
Damon pops it into shallow left. Renteria out. 2 out. Let's go back to game 7 at Yankee Stadium. Made it 9-3. This one with much more significance. Off the fencing along the foul pole down the right field line to put Boston back on top 11-9.
I don't think the Red Sox thought that ball was out, judging from the wind on the foul ball hit before the home run.
2 out, Cabrera takes the ball up and in. The 1-0 pitch, Cabrera. One ball, one strike. St. Louis in the ninth inning. We'll have Sanders, Anderson, and Molina. With two out, Cabrera, strike two. Papa Jack, Ron Jackson, the hitting coach for the Red Sox. His reaction. Lynn Jones, the first base coach. Ron Jackson in the background. And a two-run Red Sox lead again. Here's a 1-2 to Cabrera. Rolling. Inning over. A one-out error by Veritek. And a two-run shot by Bellhorn. Ninth inning, game one, 11-9 Red Sox. Julian Tavares just came back and sat down in the Cardinal dugout after giving up the two-run home run to Bellhorn. It's 11-9, Boston on top, ninth inning, strike one to Sanders. Pokey Reese takes over at second base for Bellhorn. Bellhorn has been on base four times tonight out of the number nine spot. Sanders out in front of the changeup, 0-2. Folk would be the winner, Tavares the loser, unless the Cardinals rally here in the ninth inning. Sanders looking for his first hit of the night. Polar Express play of the game is the home run in the bottom of the eighth. Off the bat of Mark Bellhorn. Boston two outs away from taking game one. Marlon Anderson strike one. Cardinals had their chance last inning. Back-to-back errors on plays by Manny Ramirez in left. It tied it. Had the bases loaded. One out. Rowland popped up. Edmund struck out looking. One ball, one strike on Anderson with Yadier Molina on deck. Anderson 0 for 1 since taking over for the injured Tony Womack. Hit in the left collarbone area on a bad hop ground ball to his left. Strike two. Your late local news will be next, except for those of you on the West Coast. For those of you watching in the Boston area, Fox 25 News will have an expanded edition immediately after the game, as well as KTVI Channel 2 in St. Louis. 2-2 on Anderson. That's ball three. The Red Sox trying to win a game in which their starter went only 3 2/3. They committed four errors defensively. But to this point, they have outlasted Tony La Russa's Cardinals. It's 11-9. Anderson trying to get it started. Off the end of the bat, still a full count.
Shows you what kind of confidence Keith Folk has in a changeup. When you're ahead by two runs in the ninth inning, and you can throw the changeup on a 3-2 count, that means you can get it over as well as a fastball.
And Anderson down the left field line. That ball is fair. Anderson with a double here with one out in the ninth inning, and the Cardinals not going away quietly with Yadier Molina coming up.
Anderson, very good at bat, jam. Just slices it down the left field line, and he's on second. So now the Cardinals have the potential tying run at the plate.
And it's their young catcher in his rookie season, Yadier Molina. Cardinals pinch ran for Matheny last inning. Strike one on Molina. Two big league home runs for Molina. Runner at second, one out, no balls, one strike. Molina sticks the bat out and hits it foul down the right field line, 0-2. Double by Marlon Anderson. And an 0-2 count on Yadier Molina, one out. Minkiewicz. Two out. And Roger Cedeno, who's one for one tonight, steps in. Three home runs during the regular season for Cedeno. Strike one.
Looks like Cedeno has moved up in the box a little bit to protect against the changeup from Keith Foulke. A lot of times a catcher can watch the feet of the hitter and call pitches.
The Red Sox one strike away from taking game one.
Two fastballs to Cedeno, and it does look like Roger had moved up a little bit on Keith Foulke. A lot of hitters will do that again to protect against the changeup.
Changeup, Cedeno strikes out, and the Red Sox win it 11-9. Came on the air talking about the potential of seeing a lot of offense and wondering which bullpen would latch onto a lead, hang on to the lead, and finish it. And it's Keith Foulke, so valuable in the ALCS, getting the victory here in game one. Bellhorn with the two-run homer, and here's how it ended. Two fastballs and a changeup.
Red Sox fans getting used to superb performances by Keith Foulke.
Celebrating here at Fenway Park in Boston. Tavares just sitting and thinking, and a final of 11-9, Boston winning game one. World Series fact, the game one winner has won the World Series 60% of the time in 13 of the last 16. We welcome you to the Bank of America postgame show. And let's check in with Chris Myers.
Down on the field, Joe, fans cheering with Keith Falk and also Mark Bellhorn. Thanks both for hanging around. First, Mark, and talk about the game-winning home run.
I don't know. It was a battle up there. He threw a couple good pitches inside, and I hit the one pretty good, but the wind's kind of blowing, and it blew it foul. And the last pitch was a slider, and I just put a good swing on it.
Third straight game here with a home run in the postseason. You're rather calm and relaxed. You just won Game One of the World Series here at Fenway.
Yeah, no, it's a nice feeling. Struggled a little bit early in the playoffs, and started feeling a lot better in the last two games in New York, and I was just hoping it'd carry through here.
All right, congratulations again. All right, and Keith, after what happened in the eighth inning, tough for Manny Ramirez. It looked like it slipped away. Obviously, he came through for you.
Yeah, you know, it's one of those things. It's, you know, that's why you play the game. You know, it's those are tough breaks, but, you know, it's a challenge. But you know what? We've been dealt with, you know, we've had to deal with challenges all year. And, yeah, it's just another challenge that we've overcome right there.
What was going through your mind when it looked like you guys had a five-run lead early in the game? Looked like it might be easy. They battle back. You don't know what's going to happen. And then you're out there, the lead slips away, and then you're out there trying to save it, even with the tying run at the plate.
You know, it's the same mindset all the time. You know, I never shut it down mentally until the game's over. You know, you go out there, you got to do your job. Two best teams in baseball, you know it's never going to be easy.
How critical to take game one?
It's big. It's a hell of a lot better than being down 0-3.
All right, thanks, Keith.
Thank you.
All right, appreciate it. Joe, back up to you.
All right, Chris, thank you. And thanks to those two guys for sticking around. The Bank of America postgame show will continue. There's the biggest swing of the night. The two-run home run by Bellhorn in the eighth. The Red Sox win game one. And our postgame show will continue after this break from Fenway Park.